go in the future.
I'm Chris Richardson, and this is Not a Pipe Podcast. Today, I'm excited to be speaking with Andrew Ferguson, whose book, The Rise of Big Data Policing, Surveillance, Race, and the Future of Law Enforcement, is a timely and important work. I know I say that about a lot, but those are the only people I invite onto the podcast are people that I think are doing really great work that needs to be heard by a lot of people, and this book definitely falls into that category. So, Andrew, first of all, thank you so much for being on the show today. You introduce a concept, black data, that I want to ask you about. Maybe you could describe it a little bit. And of course, I want to ask you later about bright data and blue data, which you use to describe different forms of the kind of information we're going to be talking about today. But yeah, maybe you could say a little bit about that and its importance and relevance in your book.
Right. So the book talks about the problem of big data policing, about how new technologies are changing where police patrol, who they target, how they investigate, in many ways changing the relationship between police and the citizens that they patrol and work with. And the idea of black data is that all of this big data policing has a black data problem. Black data meaning three related things. One is that it has a race problem. A lot of the data that has been taken as inputs into these big data systems come from the real world. And in a lot of cases, in a lot of cities, that real world is racially coded and it's racially encoded. So the data gets encoded with some of that same racial bias. It's also black because it's distorting. We can't quite see clearly. Our legal doctrine that we have comes from an age of before big data, before really any data. And so as you apply new data technologies to old-fashioned policing and old-fashioned law, the rules just aren't clear. So you're seeing distorted, you're seeing the darkness, and you're seeing that we really haven't created what's going to come next in terms of law or regulation or rules. And it's also black because it isn't transparent. Like, this is a black box problem. The fact that we cannot see into these algorithms that are governing police, we cannot understand them because of both the math and the proprietary nature of them. And so we have this sort of threefold black data problem where, as we embrace these new big data technologies, we can't see into them. We know that they have race bias problems, and the law, as we look out in the future, just isn't clear at all.
Yeah, I found that to be a really interesting concept or way of approaching it. And of course, I hope to talk to you in a few minutes, I guess, about the idea of bright data and the differences or the changes that we can possibly make. But first, I'm curious if there's any project or algorithm or big data idea that got you thinking and pushed you towards actually writing this book?
Well, you know, I've been a law professor now for about 9 years. And before that, I was a public defender in Washington, D.C. I represented poor people accused of crime. And it was a big urban city, big urban cases. And I sort of got into this whole data-driven question in court, because every time I represented a client who was arrested in a particular area, the police officer always said that he had arrested my client in a quote-unquote high crime area. And that was a legal term of art. The Supreme Court has blessed it as meaning something. But I sat there in court really puzzled of, like, what is a high crime area? Are there higher crime areas? Are there lower crime areas? Don't we have data on this? Shouldn't we have data on this? Isn't this exactly sort of a data-driven question that should be answered rather than just having a police officer talk about it? And it turned out that no one really had done any of the sort of quantitative understanding, at least as it applied in the court of law. And so I started as a lawyer exploring it and asking for the records behind it, trying to do some of the data crunching myself. And then when I transitioned into being a law professor, I started studying how these sort of data-driven ideas were changing law. And so I happened to have joined the Legal Academy about 9 years ago, which was at the moment that predictive policing burst onto the stage. Predictive policing being the idea that you could actually quantify various crime patterns and then predict where the next crime might be, where to send your police car to stop that crime and the rest of it. And so I started studying this rise of predictive policing, which then morphed from place-based predictive policing of the places where crime might occur to people who might be involved in crime, to then this larger surveillance world where we now have artificial intelligence cameras watching people. And I've sort of been exploring it as it has evolved, giving me, you know, puzzle after puzzle to try to figure out, which all sort of resulted into this book, which said, you know, there's this real problem that society is facing where our policing systems, our prosecution systems, our investigative systems are actually being distorted by technology. And we're not really paying attention to how it's changing things, how it's changing our constitutional rights, how it's changing civil rights, and how it's changing the relationship between police and citizens.
Yeah. So a quick clarification. When you were working on cases and people were referring to high crime areas, was this before or during the use of computers or algorithms for this?
So it was before there was actually algorithms, but it wasn't before that there was data being collected. So what I would do actually as a public defender was, when I knew that the prosecution was going to claim that this area was a quote-unquote high crime area, I would actually subpoena for all the crime statistics that police do keep and get the information beforehand. So I could either argue that this really wasn't, by your own numbers, a high crime area, or if it was, I just didn't make that argument. And I found that there was this whole world of crime analysts out there. There was this whole world of, you know, data-driven police efficiency that was moving, you know, patrol cars in particular places at particular times. And I realized people weren't really studying it as either a legal problem or even a criminology problem. And so I started just diving into it and seeing what I could find out about how it was really affecting police on the ground, how it was affecting communities, how it was affecting racial relations. And the end product was this book.
I mean, it's a really fascinating look at how things have changed, especially with this idea of big data, which I think most people think of as a relatively new thing. And in many ways it is. But like you said, police crime data has existed for a very long time. What's changing, if anything, with the use of big data and these number crunching machine learning algorithms that's different than when people would be writing this down and calculating how many crimes are happening, you know, in a certain area, possibly by hand, or if not by hand, then at least not with the kind of technology that we have today?
Well, I think it's a nice parallel to what we see in the consumer space or really any other part of our lives, right? We've always had data. We've always had information. You know, the precursor to Walmart knew how many widgets it sold every day. But the idea with big data is that you can take sort of this volume and velocity and different kinds of data that are coming through the variety part of it and use that same insight, but over a broader sort of subset of the population or the data sets coming in and be able to find insights or get predictive value out of the information coming in. So it's a function of taking what we've always been doing, but because our computers are getting smarter and better, because we're now able to crunch things into different kinds of algorithms, we can actually have real world change. And just as a real example, so what's happening now in a whole host, probably like 30 to 60, depending on how you count, cities in America, is that those same crime statistics that have always been part and parcel of a police officer's sort of consciousness. It used to be literally like a picture, a map on a wall, and they put little thumbtacks in about where the crimes were, right? That was a data collection mechanism. Mm-hmm. But now all those data pieces are being put into a system, a data system, and run through an algorithm so that police can now quote unquote predict or forecast a higher risk area of crime. So for example, if there's a series of burglaries in a particular neighborhood, it's actually statistically more likely that there will be other burglaries in that neighborhood. Why? Either because there's some environmental vulnerability in that area that's sort of causing the risk to go up. There's maybe no police in the area, or everyone's gone away for Christmas and that the houses are all abandoned. Or maybe it's just the same group of burglars who are going into that area and stealing things until they're caught. They're going to keep going back because houses are kind of built the same. Escape routes are the same. Anyway, statistically, it has been shown that there are certain kinds of crimes are almost viral, like they almost have a viral contagion aspect to it. And you can predict that. And so predictive policing in a police-based way is used to sort of take that insight, apply an algorithm to the forecast of where the crimes will be, and then send the police car to that area. If you know, or if it's predicted that it's more likely that there'll be a burglary in this place at this time, you place a police car at that area, and there's odds are that that will deter the burglar from coming back and doing his next burglary. And that's sort of theory in its very basic form of some kind of place-based predictive policing.
You talk about, even in the book, this there's this now a sort of cliche of comparing this to Minority Report, a book by Philip K. Dick about policing future, where people predict who and where a crime will be committed, and they stop that person before it happens. A lot of people, I guess, seeing this kind of technology fear that this is what we're facing. And of course, that raises a lot of questions about free will and stuff like that. What is similar or different than some science fiction like Minority Report with what we're dealing with today?
Well, we don't have precogs in their gel to forecast who the murderer will be. But in some ways, when you move from place-based predictive policing, which is really looking at crime, past crime data, and using a risk formula to forecast where crime might be more likely, and putting police there, which doesn't actually impact the citizens on the street, doesn't necessarily mean that there will be a contact. In fact, if you take place-based predictive policing at its word, they say, look, our goal is to deter crime, not necessarily arrest anyone else. And there's some evidence to show that that happens. But that's different from where policing has morphed to person-based predictive policing. So let me give you another example. Mm-hmm. Right now in Chicago, Illinois, the Chicago Police Department have what they call the strategic subjects list. It's actually also known as the heat list. The people who are hot are on this list. And it is a person-based predictive forecast, a risk forecast based on individuals the Chicago Police Department think are more at risk of either being the perpetrator of a violent crime or the victim of a violent crime. And they don't actually separate those two, which, as you might imagine, can cause some problems. But they don't separate those two. What they say is, look, we can look at a series of variables and predict that certain individuals are more at risk of being involved in violence. If you make this heat list, you're given a threat score, literally a numerical score from 0 to 500 plus, where the higher the score means the higher the risk. And if you make the top of that list, because there's not enough police officers to necessarily deal with all of the now hundreds of thousands of people on this list, you might actually get a knock on your door, your home door, your apartment door, by a police officer, maybe accompanied by a social worker and someone from the community to say, hey, you've made this list. We literally have a letter with your name on it called a custom notification letter. Mm-hmm. And it explains why we think that you are involved. And it's not precogs. It is that you have been arrested for this crime. Your friend was shot. We think you're involved in this gang, whatever it might be. And I can talk about the various inputs that go into it. But what it does is it uses an algorithm to identify people who are most at risk and then sends police to your door. Or in the alternative, they'll actually send you a letter and say, hey, come to this community center or come to this church or come to this police meeting and we're going to bring a bunch of you into a room to basically scare you straight and tell you we know we're watching you and we know that you're involved. But it's doing some small iteration of this idea of predictive policing, this idea of it's not Minority Report, but it's this idea of looking at individuals in society and determining that some people are more at risk than others and then intervening either through a sort of coercive police presence or in the alternative, it could be more of a social work presence.
I mean, not to belabor the comparison, but I mean, the interesting thing in that story is that, especially if people have seen the movie with Tom Cruise, they think that he's going to commit a crime and he doesn't think so or whatever. And so it plays with this idea of, you know, should he be arrested even though he hasn't done anything because he's supposed to do something? And it makes me think about this on the ground policing. I think if it was really successful, if people were able to prevent crime by giving these letters, by going to these doors and stuff like that, then theoretically you wouldn't have any stats to demonstrate that. And so if it actually works, you can't really prove that it's working because the crime never gets committed. How do we deal with predictive policing in that sense? Like, if you're successful, then there would be less crime, but then that could also just be that your numbers are wrong and you're targeting the wrong people. So how do we start to measure or weigh these things?
So that's a great insight. So the clearest example is how place-based predictive policing sort of double counts its victory. So if you predict a particular area, say a 500 by 500 square box of a neighborhood is more at risk of a crime, and you put your police car there because that's what the algorithm told you. If there is no crime, you say, hey, look, we won. We deterred the crime. If there is a crime there, you say, hey, look, we won because the crime occurred and we were there, right? Mm-hmm. And so you do win either way. Generally speaking, it's very hard to determine, and we haven't been really successful in determining whether or not any of these predictive analytics policing innovations actually work to deter crime. In the areas where the predictive policing technologies have rolled out on the place-based system, there's been some, you know, evidence that it works and some evidence that doesn't work. Person-based predictive policing, again, you know, if you look at shootings in Chicago, some places they'll say the shootings have gone down because of technology. other places, you'll say, well, the shootings are still pretty high, so it's clearly not working as well as you want. But we haven't been able to really determine whether this is actually a workable thing or not. And in the gap of that inability to determine it, we've had, you know, companies pushing this technology to say you need this or else there'll be more people dying or more crime happening. And you have chiefs of police are willing to adopt it because they want to be on the advanced curve of the next new thing to try to get ahead of crime.
Yeah. So then how does someone like yourself come in to look at this situation? I mean, I would say that you cover a lot of bases. At first, for example, you talk about, in the book, at least, the Ferguson riots. And so I was thinking, okay, this is sort of the side he's on, you know, to simplify things. But then you talk about the results of police being targeted and the kinds of repercussions and the feelings of abandonment that a lot of police departments had. And so you really, I would say, cover a lot of the different subjects in a way that doesn't necessarily put you in one place or in one team or another. How do you come in, though, to this situation looking at data-driven, predictive policing and that kind of thing and make determinations? Or do you try not to make determinations once you've looked at this? Do you try to just sort of objectively weigh the pros and cons?
You know, I try to call it as I see it. I think that the book attempts to be not a critique of big data policing just to critique it, because that is pretty easy to do.
Hmm.
It's not trying to be a fear-mongering book. It probably would sell better if it was. But it's trying to look at how these new technologies have positives and negatives. And, you know, policing in America has positives and negatives, and you have to be sort of conscious of it. You know, the book tries to tell the story of why are we here at this moment of starting to embrace these technologies. And it talks about a couple pressure points that were happening at the time we saw the real adoption of it. One was the racial unrest that was happening post-Ferguson, post-Staten Island, post-Freddie Gray, the repetitive conflicts and then responses to communities and policing that created a new tension. And one of the reactions to that from police was, well, we recognize the real human bias, the racial bias that's implicit and explicit in our police forces. So we need a new thing. You know what that new thing is going to be? Data. Because why? Data is objective. And that was a good selling point for police departments to try to turn the page from the real tension that was emerging from communities. But it's a sort of false argument, right? Because the data isn't any more objective than anything else. The data comes from the real world. It comes from real policing. It comes from real communities. And so you can't simply turn the page. You have to really acknowledge and peel back the racial problems in policing to get to an answer. That doesn't mean, and this is one of the nice things about data, that doesn't mean that going into a data-driven system isn't actually a way to reveal some of those biases. In fact, the part of the reason we know that stop and frisk in New York is racially biased is because we have the data to show it. Part of the reason we know that the killings of unarmed African-American men is so prevalent is that we now are starting to collect the data to show it. And so data can be revealing in its way. And so my approach to all of these technologies is to be sort of agnostic as I come in to say, I understand why there are pressures to do more with less. I think chiefs of police have the hardest job that people have because they have to answer the unanswerable question of what are you going to do about crime? And the real answers for that chief are, well, I'd like more money for education and social services and environmental cleanup and lead out of the homes. And I'd like a little bit of opportunity and job hope for my community. But they can't get any of that. The thing that they can rely on, I'll take a new black box technology that promises that I can do more with less. That's what I can do. That's what I control. And at least I'll have a response when you, the community, ask me to answer that unanswerable question and then don't give me the funds to do it. And so like my response to all of this is that it's complex and it's hard and it takes, you know, smart people to think about some of these problems at the front end. And the final thing I'll say about the why and how I approach it is this book is an attempt to ask a series of questions that I don't think have been asked yet. Asked about the new technologies, asked about policing, asked about race in America, in a way that lots of other people can then, having those questions been asked, can start coming up with answers. I don't have all the answers, but I do think that this book sort of exposes some of the fault lines and questions that need answering as we move forward, you know, past the rise of big data policing and into, you know, the full embrace of big data policing.
To build on that, I mean, you talk about, of course, policing. You also talk about programs that exist for the possibilities of recidivism and these kinds of things that help judges in some cases make decisions, and so sentencing. But as you say, all of this, the courts and the police departments, relate to much bigger real-world issues that are going on outside of courts and precincts. And so how do you decide how far out to go? Because, I mean, you are talking about primarily policing, but then once you ask questions about who's getting arrested, why are they getting arrested, and these kinds of things, it goes into much bigger sort of historical, socioeconomic situations. How do you weigh how far out from policing to go when you're looking at this picture?
Well, I think you have to take into account, you know, the history of race and surveillance when you're talking about any new predictive policing technology. I don't think you can say that, oh, this is some new futuristic technology that has nothing to do with the fact that every time we have seen an innovation of surveillance, we've turned it on communities of color and poor people first. And I think that we do ourselves a disservice when we don't ask those questions. It doesn't mean you don't embrace the surveillance technologies in some way or another eventually, but you should do it conscious of that it is happening against this backdrop of the tensions in America. You shouldn't simply think that you turn the page on racial tension in America by saying a technology will fix it without actually interrogating the fact that a lot of those same problems will exist in the new technology. A great example of that is in New York City, right? So New York City has been at the forefront of adopting sort of a data-driven approach to policing. There were, at a moment in time, in the early parts of New York's sort of, you know, miracle of reducing the crime rates, Chief Braddon, William Braddon at the time, came in and adopted the CompStat method, which was basically using data and using computers and using analysis to sort of redirect resources. And he credits that with bringing crime down. But then when stop and frisk was declared unconstitutional after, you know, there were over 600,000 stops a year going on, they actually brought Chief Braddon back to New York for his second stint as commissioner. And he said, look, don't worry, we're going to turn the page on stop and frisk. It's no longer going to be a part of our situation. We have a new solution called predictive policing. It's called proactive policing. It'll be fine. And everyone sort of took that as like, oh, okay, well, I'm glad we moved past a racist tactic to something new and innovative without asking the hard question of, well, obviously, this data that you've been using for stop and frisk and you've been using for everything else is going to be impacting this new predictive policing technology. You can't simply say that these big questions are no longer applicable. Of course they're applicable. And you can't close your mind to the fact that they are influencing the outcomes. And what we've seen in policing, what we've seen in other sorts of forms of algorithmic bias, is that if you don't ask those hard questions, if you don't interrogate the potential bias in all these systems, you're going to get a biased outcome. And that is a real problem when you're talking about public safety and public policing.
One thing that has always been an issue that I've been interested in thinking about, and I really don't know how to even begin, is that if you go to, say, a criminology conference where there's experts in criminology, they will talk about the data and they will talk about the ways in which crime prevention is working or not working. And a lot of that is statistics and data driven. However, if you go to a political science conference and they're talking about how to get votes, basically, in terms of what works, not necessarily how it should be, but what works is you talk about fears of crime and then people will vote for you, basically. And I mean, obviously that's very simplified, but it makes me think that if you put criminologists in charge of preventing crime, then you would get a very different approach than if you have politicians who ultimately do make a lot of the decisions and push a lot of the policy, but they don't necessarily, they're not necessarily interested in the question of data-driven policing. What they're interested in is how to get more votes. And so, I mean, like in New York City, for example, stop and frisk data shows that it is basically racially biased. But there is a large group of constituents that feel like they should. I remember Trump saying that stop and frisk was a good thing and he supported it. In this era, sort of, it seems, of whatever you want to call it, like post-truth, it seems that some people are very concerned with data, computer scientists, for example. But then there is a large population in the US and elsewhere that aren't necessarily concerned with data. Are those simply two different conversations, or do you see them mixing in some way? Or I guess, how do you work with data-driven science in an age of post-truth?
It's a big question.
Yeah. If you can solve that in the next few minutes, I'd appreciate it.
You know, I think that the difference in the policing context is police chiefs and politicians do have to respond to fear, and they do respond to fear. Mm-hmm. But part of their response in recent years has been to push data-driven policing. So take Baltimore, for example. Baltimore has a crime rate that is, you know, unacceptable, way too many people dying. They have the post-Freddie Gray racial tensions that date well before Freddie Gray, but are real mm-hmm. in terms of the relationship between the Baltimore Police Department and the community. They have a mayor who wants to do something about it. And the response has been to this crisis of race and crisis of fear is, well, don't worry, we are going to move into predictive policing. We're going to do big data policing. We're going to add new surveillance cameras. We're going to hire the architect of predictive policing in LA and Chicago and bring them to Baltimore. We're going to respond in this way. And so you respond to the fear. People want an answer, whatever that answer will be, even if it doesn't necessarily work. And you can respond to the data-driven people who are saying, hey, data really does help. There are technologies to do it. In the same breath, which is actually, to me, the convergence. Like, that's actually why we see this move toward big data policing happening so effortlessly. It actually plays into both political interests and data interests in a way that is beneficial to both. The open question from that is, well, is this simply a political answer and we don't really care about whether it works or not? Or is it a way to getting better answers? Because if criminologists are invited in, if data scientists are invited in, we might actually get some insights that could be helpful. You know, they're not going to be the silver bullet that, I mean, it's a bad word. It's not going to be the silver solution is going to improve everything in Baltimore. But maybe you'll get more insight about what is going on and how to improve it. And so I think there's this temptation that because of this convergence of interests of, you know, you cut funding for police, you have racial tension, you have a fear of crime, and all of that leads to an answer of, like, we need a solution. What's our solution? And then when someone shows up and says, hey, I got this fancy new black box technology that's going to solve all your problems, everyone says, okay, we got it. We'll buy that. And that's what's been happening, whether or not we know that the black box actually is helpful or not.
There are a lot of, as you, you know, discuss in your book, pros and cons. One thing that I found amazing that struck me was that in California, a state auditor found that 42 infants were recognized as gang members because of the algorithm that they were using.
Yeah, I mean, gang databases are notoriously error-filled. In fact, all data in policing system is filled with error, in part because most police, you know, officers don't get into the policing world to be data entry people. It's not necessarily what they want. It's also a job where you are routinely sleep deprived and running from thing to thing, emergency to emergency, and somehow the data collection inputting part isn't always the most important piece of it. And we haven't invested the money to create systems to audit it. And you know, obviously those infants in the CalGang database could be easily caught because the year of their birth doesn't make any sense. But you got to have an auditor who's going to do that, who's going to cleanse this data. We do it all the time in other forms of commercial space where we think the data matters more. We just haven't invested the money into improving police data systems. And so you get these systems that are rife with error. And then the hardest part is when these technologies and systems start sharing information, you can't always clear the data. It might be cleared in the system where you first inputted it, but it might have been shared in federal systems, in fusion systems, across state lines, in different kinds of partnerships, in ways that you can't go back and fix all the error across the board. And so you have these systems that are literally impacting people's lives, like whether you get arrested, whether you get a threat score, whether someone knocks on your door, and we don't know if they're accurate or not.
Yeah. So then how do we move or take steps to move from that kind of situation to what you're calling bright data in contrast to the black data? How do we make it brighter? Maybe you can say a few things about, first of all, how you're using that term, and then also what are some of the things that you would hope to see?
So, you know, part of the thematic, you know, argument in the book is I have this problem of black data. I talk about the problem of blue data, which is maybe we could use technology and data we have on police to improve police accountability. And then there's bright data. And bright data's insight is essentially, like, maybe the problem with predictive policing is the policing part. The idea of having predictive analytics that could look at a particular neighborhood and say, you know, there's something about the environmental risk factors that are going to encourage criminal activity in this spot. Or looking at a particular individual, say, you know, there's something about this individual's life and patterns and friendships and arrest pattern that shows that they are more at risk than others of being involved in crime or being involved in, you know, a violent act. that risk identification doesn't necessarily require a policing remedy. You don't have to put a police car in the area you've identified as a high-risk area. You could actually build a park, put a job center, you know, put new lights up, do something environmentally to deal with that environmental risk you found in the place. Or for a person, you don't have to send a police detective with a letter on your door saying why we're watching you. You could simply send a person in the community and say, hey, we see that you're making these choices in life. Here are the consequences. Here's a job. Here's a mentor. Here's a GED equivalent, whatever you can do. It doesn't have to be policing, but we've conflated the risk identification and the remedy because we've funded it that way. Predictive policing is all about, you know, watching the money. Where's the money come from? It comes from federal grants through, you know, Department of Justice and all these sort of policing focused areas. It comes from private companies that are willing to give money to police and not necessarily to social services. But it doesn't have to be that way. The risk identification piece of it might actually be a benefit to society if we are careful about how we use that data. And if we invested the same amount of money in those social services as we did in policing, we might actually be able to get to some of these underlying problems with a long-term solution. And so the idea of, you know, bright data is to sort of separate out risk and remedy and maybe remove the police from this idea of risk identification. But underlying the whole book, which is what you were getting at in the beginning, is that we need to ask all of these questions at the front end. What has happened right now? The story of big data policing is not a bunch of chiefs of police sitting in a room and saying, you know, I really would like this technology. If only someone created this technology. Instead, it's a bunch of tech companies, startups, and other companies that are basically going to chiefs and say, hey, you need this technology. You need this black box miracle here, without a whole lot of thought at the front end about what the risks are, how policing and public safety is different than the consumer space, how a lot of the risks that we just talked about over the past few minutes are identifiable at the front end. We could have thought about all these at the front end if we had lawyers at the table, if we had ethicists at the table, if we had criminologists at the table in designing these technologies, we might not have many of the problems that we have now, but they weren't there. And so we're sort of playing catch up to say, you know, I get why you innovated this way, but here are the following things you didn't think about. And here's why, if you go in the future, you should. Here are things you need to think about before you, you know, keep adopting these technologies or adopt the next generation of technologies.
Oh, and while I was reading, I couldn't help but think about this idea that Ulysses Mejias has about nodocentrism, where we focus on the nodes of a network, and then the paranodal, the things that are outside of those, kind of disappear. And I mean, the terms that are being used, especially by, like you said, the tech firms that are sort of selling this, is that it's smart technology, it's predictive, it's intelligent policing, all of these kinds of things, which sound really good because the opposite of smart or intelligent is not something I want to be seeing, right? But that seems to negate a lot of the things that are missing. For example, as you mentioned in the book, a lot of the crime stats were based on property crime because that's very easy to demarcate, whereas if you're in the middle of a sort of complex crime that started in one place, got pursued to another place, then it's very hard to mark that and map that. So taking a step back, what is it that we're able to see very well from your work in looking at this? What appears very nicely in these sort of nodes of this network mapping? And then what doesn't appear? What are we not seeing when we use this kind of policing framework?
Right. So it's a great question. So the reason why place-based predictive policing technologies evolved was actually there was a whole, you know, several decades worth of social science that basically saw this same insight that some crime, usually property-based crime, was contagious, almost viral. And so the academics who created PredPol, which is one of the leading companies in this space, an anthropologist and a data guy who started it based on their sort of academic interests, recognized that place-based crime could be categorized in a different way than other kinds of crime, in part because for many people, it's reported the most often. Mm-hmm. Some of that's due to sort of insurance incentives, right? So if your house gets burglarized, I mean, if you're in a certain socioeconomic class, you call the insurance company. If your car gets stolen, you usually call your car insurance company. And so there are these calls for service that are independent of arrests, not just necessarily where the police are, and are located or centered at the person who was harmed, the person who lost their property. And so they built this sort of technology around that, which is great in the sense of it works on some crime. But police want more than that, right? They want to know stop the shootings. People care about shootings when they care about burglars. They want people to stop gang violence. And so the technology is sort of evolved outside of what we knew to be true from social science in ways that just were not tested the same way. And the danger in adopting a really data-driven system is you stop seeing all the other crime because you can't record it, you can't input it, and you don't get credit for it. So there are lots of crimes, domestic violence, sexual assault, other crimes internally to the home that will not be given the same focus as those crimes that tend to happen outside or tend to happen in the eyes of police or in the lens of police patrols. And as a result, you're going to get a distorted view of what crime is actually happening and where to direct your resources. And that's a problem if you don't catch it. It's an obvious problem. One with a sophisticated data system could easily correct against, but also not one that we're necessarily seeing people see that as a problem yet, because people aren't asking these hard questions at the front end.
Well, is there a way then to start capturing crimes that are not necessarily seen as obviously, like you said, domestic abuse, rape cases, these things that may be happening, but it's more of a question of who's reporting it as opposed to insurance claims? Are these inherently going to be sort of missing from the data, or do you see these as things that need to be incorporated better?
I think that there's a whole series of crimes that will be inherently missing from the data, and we've known that for a long time. We also know that in certain socioeconomic classes, in certain communities that don't trust the police, those property-based crimes also get underreported because you don't want to necessarily call the police to your house that was just burglarized, because dealing with the police is more of a hassle than dealing with the insurance that you don't have. So my point is more that we just need to be conscious as we start investing in data-driven systems that we don't forget that much of the crime out there is not going to be cataloged in these systems. But what happens with sort of this data-driven focus is you measure what you can measure. And so that's what you fund. That's where you send your police. And if we don't see that there's a potential distortion in that because we can't see all the crime, you're going to get a distorted policing response and a distorted sense of whether you are addressing the real crime problems in society. We're seeing it now. This is sort of, you know, a slight tangent, but you're seeing it now in the immigrant community in America that are now afraid to report crimes to the police, local police, for fear that ICE and Homeland Security might find out about it. So it looks like crime is going down in these areas, but it's simply that crime is being underreported in these areas. Crime's still happening. People just aren't reporting it. And that's its own danger, because people will take the narrative of, look, crime is going down in these predominantly new immigrant communities. And that's simply not true, but is true if all you care about is the data you've collected. And we just have to be aware of it. Part of writing the book and raising these issues is we need this new awareness of the limitations of data, even as we embrace a data-driven system.
Historically, a lot of people who wanted to claim that people of color were inherently more criminal and these kinds of things could point to data, because those communities were being policed more and thus more arrests were happening. And so obviously there are a lot of problems with that, but you could use data and statistics if you wanted to sort of skew it to prove effectively that these communities are more criminogenic and that therefore they're, you know, worse or what have you. And so as you identify that, you can identify problems with that. But then is that kind of issue always going to be within data? The issue of who are you targeting? How are you counting? And what do you want to prove? So for example, yeah, if you have sort of racist intentions, you can quote unquote prove that communities that are predominantly people of color are more criminal because you've sent police in and then you've collected more numbers. It seems like that kind of situation, wherever it's targeted, is almost inherent to data-driven anything. Do you see that as inevitable, or is this something that can be improved through things like oversight?
I think it is an inevitable risk. It is something that we've seen wherever we have, you know, tried to use big data systems or algorithms. The underlying inherent bias is revealed by people paying attention. And so whether you're thinking about a Google search, you know, Sophia Noble's excellent book called The Algorithms of Oppression to show how sort of biased the Google searches are, again, looking at how we have taken sort of data in certain ways and peeling the system apart to recognize all of the choices that go into it that create bias is necessary to also happen in the policing space. To say that all algorithms and all big data systems will be biased is, I think, a truthful statement. But I also think that recognizing that allows for a certain kind of oversight, correction, sampling that can also happen because we have the data. As a small insight about how this could potentially work, and this is a very small pilot from a very small company in one particular place, but in Chicago, Illinois right now, Chicago Police is piloting a predictive policing system run by Hunch Lab. Hunch Lab is one of these small startups that runs predictive policing technologies. And they guide police to particular areas at particular times to look for particular crimes that there's more risk for. But because they are conscious of the potential racially biased impact of those predictions, they also have, as part of their algorithm, part of their model, a system where if police have been sent to an area too often, even though it is identified as being a high-risk area, they will wait it so the officer doesn't go there, as a recognition that there are external costs to over-policing, lack of trust, you know, undermining community. So in the algorithm, even though the forecast says, hey, send your police officer to this block at this time for this crime, because the police officer's been there too many times, according to the algorithm, in the past, it will override and say, don't go there. Again, that's using data to recognize that your system could be seen as racially biased and using that same system to counteract it. With enough thought and with enough sort of oversight and transparency and critique, those kinds of things are possible in a big data system. And the response, of course, is, well, they'll still be biased. I think that's true. But policing itself is sort of potentially always biased as well. And if you are comparing, is this better to the ordinary practice where we just sent police off wherever they wanted to go on their own hunches and ideas of communities and who lived in those communities? It may be the case that you want this kind of sort of visualization of where police are going to prevent the otherwise pretty subjective hunch-based policing patterns that we've had forever. And that this might be a step forward, not a complete solution, but a step forward in using data to get a more balanced system of policing certain communities.
I'm wondering how your experience in your book, this book itself, Rise of Big Data Policing, has been, I guess, perceived, or if you've gotten any kind of responses. Because like I said, it's really impressive that I think people interested in social justice movements could read this book and get a lot out of it, but also people who seem to be sometimes on the other side, you know, interested in policing and in determining where crime is happening in order to prevent it. A lot of different communities could find a lot of things to like, but also potentially things to not like in terms of your critiques. How have you found the reception of this book in different places?
You know, the overall reception, be it from police chiefs or community groups or tech companies, is that it's fair. It's fair to the criticisms and it's fair to the complexities. I think it probably would sell better if I had taken all big data policing is a racist minority report danger, because somehow that is an easier sell. But I think it's harder. And I think my job as an academic and as someone who is trying to take the perspectives of all these people into consideration as I evaluate it, is to see that this stuff is hard. You know, I've talked to the people who came up with the predictive policing technologies, and I think they have good hearts. I think they're at this for the right reason. And I think they realize that sometimes their systems weren't fully thought out at the front end and maybe could be improved. And some of them are actually reacting to that and responding to it, which is great. I think that chiefs realized that they didn't even know what questions to ask necessarily when they were pitched by these companies, and have found the book to be valuable in terms of being able to see some of the problems that they literally just didn't think about when they were pitched this grand new technology paid for by a federal grant. And I think that communities have also recognized that they needed a vocabulary to start asking some of these hard questions about whether they want these technologies in their systems. You know, at the end of the book, I basically make a pitch for that. You know, one of the ways to respond to big data policing is to have local surveillance summits, like this idea that once a year or more, you would have a community get together where the chief would have to get up in front of the community and explain, defend, argue why he or she is spending taxpayer money on this particular new technology, why they think it works, why they don't think it will be racist, why they think it will improve the efficiency and effectiveness of policing. And the community can ask those hard questions, and technologists can be in the room, academics can be in the room, and we could have a conversation about some of these sort of balancings between liberty and security, public safety and privacy that we need to have, because there's no one right answer. And in fact, it might very well be different. You know, what people are okay with in Los Angeles may not be the same thing that people are okay with in Berkeley or Oakland. And what people are okay with in Texas might be very different from what people are okay with in Boston. And so I think there's a local solution, but it requires local communities to actually educate themselves about the risks and rewards of these new technologies, which is what the hope of the book is all about, is to get people to actually start having these conversations locally, and then it will evolve eventually into a national conversation.
I like how you mentioned that, especially because it seems like these are technologies that are out there and that we just have to deal with and accept, whereas a dialogue does demonstrate sort of the potential for continual change and rethinking certain things. I'm curious, I guess pretty much my last question, are there areas that remain opaque, either in general in terms of the study of this kind of stuff, or to you that you're interested in particular in looking into? What are some areas that still need to be sort of unpacked and explored, and maybe are you thinking about doing that?
So I think that for policing right now, I think that there is an interesting change going on if you follow the money. There is sort of a race right now to be the platform for policing, the digital platform for policing. Companies like Axon, which are focused on police body cameras, where they're like literally giving away body cameras for free because they realize that the money is all in the storage of those body cam footage, and then being able to provide the camera footage to courts through evidence, it's called evidence.com, but an evidence-based system, is a way to sort of capture the policing space and become the sole provider for police. You see other companies, startups, trying to sort of consolidate to also being that kind of platform. There's a small startup called Mark 43 that basically wants to take all police records, like all the paperwork that police have to do, which all police officers hate, and digitize it and say, we'll make it automated. We'll have GPS, so we'll know where you are. We'll be able to take your voice recordings and put it into the police forms. You'll never have to sign a police form. Wonderfully attractive if you're a police officer or an administrative thing. But again, you become the platform for policing. Police are then, departments are locked into your system. Same thing, HunchLab was just bought by ShotSpotter, which is an audio sensor device for gunshot noise. So ShotSpotter sends police to the gunshot sounds immediately. And there's this sort of attempt, again, to become the platform for these policing systems. And I think we need to really start asking some hard questions about, well, what happens when we essentially are privatized policing? What happens when we are connecting policing and technology companies in a way that gets really sophisticated? Another good example is what's happening in LA with Palantir, the Peter Thiel company that got its start tracing terrorists across the globe, is now partnering with LAPD to do social network analysis. And that means that they're essentially creating an incredibly powerful investigative tool of all the people who get caught up into this digital web in LA to be able to use investigations. But the downside is that it's sophisticated enough that police can't necessarily use it on its own. They have to be dependent on these big technology companies. So you're kind of privatizing police. You're privatizing police data in a way that citizens lose control. And so I think there's a lot of questions to be asked about the money, the economic structures, the financial incentives, and sort of the capture that happens when a particular company becomes a policing platform. And so that's a big question that I'm sort of exploring. And the second, even bigger question is, you know, the book is all about policing and technology. I think that this idea of the datafication of criminal justice is its own bigger issue, and probably the subject of the next book that I write about how these same sort of problems play out in a system that is our criminal justice system that starts with pre-arrest to past sentencing and probation and parole.
Yeah, I mean, there's so much that we could continue talking about, but I really appreciate you taking the time today to speak with me. I think it's a fascinating issue that if people aren't aware of it, they should be. And this book really helps outline some of the key insights and key questions that we should be asking. So, Andrew, I just want to really thank you for speaking to me today.
Thank you so much for having me.
Thanks for helping support This Is Not a Pipe podcast by listening, by sharing, by leaving reviews, and supporting it however you can online on the website, tinapp.org. Also want to encourage anybody who wants to see Andrew's book recommendations or anyone else to check out the website. Ordering any of the books from the links provided, I think, makes like 10 cents for us, which is always welcome, especially if a lot of people are interested in buying some books. Until next time, I'm Chris Richardson. Cheers.